preparatory remarks. Namely, what is this all about? Why should one take an interest in these subjects, such as UFOs and so forth? So, to preface that, I'm going to just read a little bit from a conversation between a scholar and a devotee about the Ramayana. And I think this is important because it indicates one of the basic issues we're dealing with here. So, I'll just say call these persons A and B. So A, yes, and then you enter into the third khanda, B, Aranya khanda. A, Aranya khanda. That's when you enter into what I call a kind of Walt Disney world. Truly another world altogether. A, laughter, I see. B, what I mean is that in it there are talking birds and talking animals and demons and witches and all sorts of wondrous, wonderful things. A, seems like Walt Disney would be envious of some of those things. B, well, I think he certainly missed the boat by not making it into an animated spectacle. Then there's a little bit of discussion of that. So then, further comment from D. All right, and so they go off into the forest and run into all kinds of goblins and witches. They show heroism, love, compassion, chivalry, and things of that nature, and so on. So, this is a discussion of the Ramayana. And you can see in the discussion, there's a basic problem here. Namely that the position of the scholar is that the Ramayana is a sort of Walt Disney fantasy. Something along the lines of Pinocchio and Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs and so forth. And in fact, that's what comes across in the conversation, and no other point comes across in the conversation. Basically, that's what you're left with. Because after all, what can you say? It looks as though the Vedic literature is a sort of fantasy of the kind that Walt Disney might make a cartoon about, or something like that. That is the position of scholars in universities. So, why do they think that way? And what can be done about that? So, the reason that scholars think in that way is that they believe that the world is a certain way based on their education and conditioning in this modern society. So, and of course, this basic education and conditioning is there for many different people, not just scholars in universities. So according to that view of the world that people are trained up to accept, all these wondrous, wonderful things that you find in the Ramayana, or for that matter, the Bhagavatam, Krishna book, any of these different literatures, just couldn't exist. These things aren't part of the real world. They're part of some old fantasies that people used to believe in the days when they were superstitious and they didn't have modern scientific knowledge. So that is a basic problem. Now, what can you say about that? You can say, well, these shastras are the absolute truth and you should accept them. But then someone may be reluctant to accept them if they think that the world is a completely different place. That the kinds of things described in the shastras on practically every page just don't happen in the real world. These things are unreal. So that's a basic problem. Well, that's what this lecture is all about. That actually, we do live in the sort of world described in the Vedic literature. And there is a great deal of evidence indicating that that is so. So, Basically, the world described in the Vedic literature is one in which you have living beings with remarkable powers. Now, of course, even ordinary living beings as we know them, including living beings like ourselves, do have remarkable powers. But familiarity breeds contempt. The very fact that we're living and walking around and talking and doing all these things, that's quite amazing in its own right. If you study physics and chemistry, learn about covalent bonds and electron orbitals and the periodic table and all that kind of thing, and then you ask, could it be that those atoms and molecules would come together and create human beings that walk around and do all these things that we do every day? That's actually quite incredible. But we're accustomed to this, and so we take it for granted. And of course, science has the theory of evolution to explain where we came from, and so forth. So the Vedic literature, very briefly, is describing a world in which you have 8,400,000 species of life, and of these, 400,000 species are human in form, and most of them are endowed with various mystic powers, which are described in the Vedic literature. In particular, there are the eight siddhis. There is the Lagima siddhi, for example, which is the power to become lighter than the lightest. You can float through the air. Many different living beings within the universe customarily do that. For example, in the Bhagavatam, there's that painting showing Narada Muni speaking to Vyasadeva. So Vyasadeva is standing on the ground before Narada Muni, and Narada Muni is just hanging in midair in front of him. So this is a very standard thing in Vedic literature, Lagima siddhi. People can levitate. There's Vasita siddhi, the power of mental control. You can exert, if you have this Vasita siddhi, you can exert great hypnotic influence over other persons. This can be exploited in various ways by bogus yogis who pretend to be incarnations of Vishnu and so forth. They can fool people into thinking that they have all kinds of divine qualifications and so on. The basic picture of the world in the Vedic literature says the world is full of intelligent living beings. Many of them have human form. They're endowed with all kinds of mystic powers. And on a somewhat deeper level, the Vedic literature is saying that we don't see all of reality. We only see certain limited aspects of it. The whole viewpoint of modern science is that gross matter is everything. Of course, science has some aspects which are of things that are not directly visible. For example, neutrinos. You can't see a neutrino. But basically, science is saying that gross matter, as we see it, is the sum and substance of the total reality. Whereas in the Vedic literature, it is saying that there are subtle energies, and there are forms of living beings composed of subtle energy, and beyond that, there are spiritual energies and forms of living beings on the spiritual level. And in fact, the subtle type of energy came from the spiritual, and the gross energy that we know came from the subtle energy by a process of controlled creation, ultimately under the control of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So, it turns out that if you look at available evidence that is out there in the world, you can find a lot of support for this basic picture that is presented in the Vedic literature, which I was just briefly outlining. You can find a lot of evidence that supports this Vedic picture, but which actually is quite contrary to the accepted scientific picture of reality. So one subcategory of that evidence is this evidence concerning UFOs, which I'm talking about today. There are other categories also, but they'll have to be discussed in other presentations. So anyway, now, just downstairs, I heard somebody reproducing the theme music of Twilight Zone. This is customary when UFOs are mentioned. It'll happen practically every time. So the idea is that, well, this is really a pretty kooky subject. Obviously something for the National Enquirer and crackpot and so forth. No serious person would want to get involved with this kind of weird subject matter. Well, that is a widespread idea, but a lot of very serious people are getting interested in this subject, especially within recent times. Many scientists have been concerned with the whole question of UFOs, starting as far back as about 1947, or even earlier. But 1947 is when things really got going. More recently, there's been this whole phenomenon of UFO abduction, which I'm going to talk about. Just to show you the kind of people who are taking this subject matter seriously, this is a book that just came out. It's by David Jacobs, who is a professor of history at Temple University in Philadelphia. By the way, that's where Ravindra Sarup got his PhD. So he's written a book on UFO abductions. Now, those are rather far-out stories. The typical UFO abduction account, very briefly, and I'll say more about it later, is one in which a person is carried away into a UFO by strange-looking little beings. They usually have very big heads and big eyes, but short and spindly bodies, and so on. So they carry the person off into a UFO, put him on a table, paralyze him physically so that he can't move, and then poke things into his body, scan him with machines, and do all kinds of rather frightening and horrifying procedures, and then take him back so that he lives to tell the tale. There are a lot of accounts like this now. This Professor Jacobs has studied about 60 different individuals, and so he's written a book on the subject. He thinks that these abduction experiences are physically real. In other words, his thesis is that this is really happening. And he thinks that beings are coming from outer space in some kind of flying machine that we call UFOs, for lack of a better word, because U means unidentified. And they're doing these things. So the point is, he's a professor of history. Now, there's a foreword to the book by a John Matt, who's a professor of psychiatry at the Harvard University Medical School. So that's another person with quite good qualifications. And he takes this very seriously also. Now, it's interesting to see some of the ideas that he comes to here. A basic theme of modern science is that we can basically handle everything using our own intelligence and our own powers. Basically, apart from us human beings here on the earth, there are lower animals and plants and inanimate matter. So we're the most intelligent beings around. We have different problems. We get sick, we die, and so forth. But by learning to manipulate matter using our intelligence, ultimately we can solve all those problems and create a perfect world for ourselves. That's the basic picture of modern science. Unfortunately, in their attempt to do this, the results haven't been too good for the world thus far. It's been a bit of a disaster. So what then is the relevance of the UFO phenomenon? One thing, whatever the basic cause behind the UFO phenomenon may be, one impact that it has is that it conveys to people that there are intelligences within the universe, and in fact, intelligences active here on this earth, which are not under our control. This tends to give one the idea that we're dependent. Now, the ultimate conclusion that you can derive from that is that one should surrender to God. Because if we're basically the highest beings around, and there is no God, there is no soul, and so forth, then the program of figuring it all out by ourselves makes sense. But if there are other beings around who are more powerful than we are, then one has to give second thought to that program. So a natural conclusion is that one should perhaps turn to God. In other words, if there are more powerful beings, you should turn to the being that has your interests at heart. And who would that be? And also, you should turn to the most powerful being. In other words, why try and make a deal with someone who's a bit more powerful than you? They may cheat you or do who knows what. So the logical thing to do is seek out the highest power. So, just in pursuance of that idea, it's interesting that this Matt comes to conclusions like that in this foreword to his book. He says here, virtually all peoples throughout history, with the exception of the Western culture of the Newtonian Cartesian era, have experienced the universe as possessing some sort of intelligence or consciousness in which human beings participate with other animate beings and inanimate things in an enterprise that has meaning, purpose, and direction, however unfathomable these may be. So he's recognizing that our present Newtonian Cartesian culture is an exception. And he says, in the West, we seem, for reasons perhaps as mysterious as the abduction phenomenon itself, which he's talking about, to have cut ourselves off almost totally from awareness of any form of higher intelligence. But let us suppose that such an intelligence did exist, and what is more, that it was not indifferent to the fate of the earth, regarding its life forms and transcendent beauty as one of its better or more advanced creations. In other words, maybe God has a plan for the earth. So he says, and let us imagine that the imbalance created by the overgrowth of certain human faculties, a kind of techno-destructive and fear-driven acquisitiveness, were diagnosed as a basic problem. What would be done as a corrective? So, he suggests that, one thing he suggests is an invasion of our consciousness with transforming images of our self-destruction. Actually, that's the whole theme of the whole UFO phenomenon. The beings are always people always report being told by the UFO entities, you're destroying the earth, stop the nuclear testing, and all this kind of thing. So anyway, I don't want to go at too great length. Let's see if I can find where. So, yeah, where does he really say it? Yeah, well, he's talking about the possibility that humankind has broken the harmony of being, that this planet does not just exist for our pleasure, and so forth. But in order to arrest the destruction of life and to make possible the further evolution of consciousness, or whatever the anima mundi has in store, these phenomena are taking place. Anima mundi means soul of the universe in Latin. So in other words, this Harvard psychologist is not only taking the UFO phenomenon seriously, but it is causing him to think about God. And that in itself is unusual from a Harvard professor of psychology or psychiatry. After all, you may know that Sigmund Freud kicked out God completely. So that is the a bit of a preface as to the import of what I'm going to discuss. So what I'm going to do is present some of the evidence regarding the UFO phenomenon, and I have some short video clips that I'll show. Let's see. This is going to be a bit extemporaneous. Let's just see what happens here. It's going to work. This talks about some sightings in Belgium. I'll say a little bit more about them. Let's see. Push play. Okay. This is an object that's been sighted over Belgium for over a year. Hundreds of different sightings have been made.
These are exclusive, never-before-seen pictures of the UFO that is amazing Europe.
There's also a circular one.
Shot by a Belgian family on their way home from a picnic. Hundreds of witnesses, including Air Force personnel, have seen a triangular object flying through the skies over Belgium. Sometimes there is a bright red halo around it. The thing can fly as slowly as 15 miles an hour in total silence. then accelerate to twice the speed of sound in 2 seconds. Others have seen in photographs a disc-shaped object. Military officials have seen it climb and descend to thousands of feet of altitude in just seconds. It makes right-angled turns. It accelerates at an estimated rate of 40 Gs, a rate that would instantly crush a human pilot. So no one knows what it is, or what they are, if there is more than one. Twice so far, strange, acting, inexplicable blips on military radar scopes, followed by a rash of phone calls from citizens, forced the Belgian Air Force to scramble American-made F-16 fighter jets to chase the UFO. Pilots at first refused to talk, but later confirmed they had made contact, but were unable to keep up with the strange object. Even senior Belgian officers admit they cannot explain what is happening.
Exceptional. There were about 20 gendarmes, and at the same time we detected actions in the air on the radar screens that were very unconventional.
Okay. Okay. That, just to make a brief remark about that case, I attended about an hour lecture specifically on the recent Belgian sightings. There are hundreds of cases in which very respectable people have given their testimony. There are also photographs. The typical object is about as big as this building, basically. Triangular in shape with lights at the corners of the triangle. And I've also seen photographs and many different drawings by different people, all of which show basically the same thing. The Belgian military people have been unusual in that they've been open in admitting that these things are actually there and inexplicable. And I saw a videotape of the radar scope of an F-16 fighter plane that had locked in on this thing and was chasing it, except that it took off, as they said there, at an acceleration of about 40 Gs. That would crush you to a thin film of jelly if you were inside a vehicle. It was like that. So there are many different cases like this. The next thing that I was going to show here is an example of a photograph taken by a guy in New Jersey. I just have a few examples. This is the guy who took it with his little brownie box camera. This is a whole category of evidence. There's a lot of testimony along these lines. This is a photograph taken by Ed Walters in Gulf Breeze, Florida. Of the object. To this day, many different sightings are being made in Gulf Breeze, Florida. I've seen some recent videotapes showing what people are seeing there. Not just this one man, but many different people are seeing and videotaping things. This is something photographed over the Wanak Reservoir in New Jersey. Now, this, can you see this? I think it would be very difficult. There's an object there. This is a videotape made in Gulf Breeze by a guy with a Sony camcorder. Even standing right here, it's difficult to see. You see that thing there? I don't know how well you can see it. Shortly, this runs for about a minute, and what I'm going to do is show a computer-enhanced picture of what the object looks like. There it is right there again. So, basically, this object was flying back and forth out behind his home. At a distance, it appeared to be several hundred feet away. In typical fashion, when it finally goes away, it blinks out. It just disappears. This is a standard feature of these UFOs. That's just about what happens. So, a Navy physicist named Bruce McAbee tried to see if this videotape could have been hoaxed. That's always a question with regard to these things. And so, he experimented with models in which you suspend a lighted model on a pole and have a person try to videotape it. He found that it wasn't possible to produce a convincing duplicate of the object. This is a computer-enhanced thing that we'll see. You should be able to see it. That's the object there. Can you see that? There are several. These are repeated shots of the same thing. It's one short segment of the videotape, which was then enhanced using the computer. Here it's made to stand still in one place. So there are a series of segments of videotape there. So professional people are involved in investigating this subject. And this is a smooth version. I used an image smoothing technique on it to give a better idea of what it looks like. So, this is finally an attempt to get a better magnified view of what the thing looks like. So, let's just see here. Unfortunately, I just have so many frames on here, so it's just inflexible as to timing. Very odd. That's another photograph that was taken of this object. That's the famous road shot, right. Now, this is a movie that a guy made in Switzerland. Notice the tree carefully. At a certain point, you'll see the tree move right now. Oops, picture slipped just at that moment, too.
What does that mean?
Does the tree move when it went over? The indication would be, pardon me?
It wasn't a fake.
But it wasn't a fake. I'll discuss the question of whether this was faked or not just a little bit. It would be quite difficult to fake this. I'll just stop this and talk a little bit about it. That last thing you saw was the path that the thing was following. I used a computer to figure that out. Basically, in order to fake this, what you'd have to do is use a model suspended from a string. And you could try and swing a small model on a string. However, if you look at the quality of the image, you'll see that it has the same degree of blurriness as the tree in the background, which is a large tree. So a small model held close up would not be like that. It would be sharper. So in order to make the image blurry to the same degree as the image at the distance, as an object at the distance of the tree, you'd have to edit each image. Now, you can do that in Hollywood frame by frame. I'm not saying that this couldn't be faked. Hollywood can do it, no doubt about it. But it's an expensive proposition. I've done some work myself with video, and it would be very difficult to create this kind of image. In fact, I couldn't do it with the facilities that I've got. So then the point that when it flies over the tree at a certain point, the tree moves, suggesting that wind from the thing has moved the branches of the tree. You could try to fake that by maybe, you can imagine somebody having a rope and pulling on the tree at just the right moment when the model is swinging. That would be difficult too. Another point is that the swing, you might say, is pendulum-like. It's going around like this. You can experiment with a handheld pendulum and see if you can duplicate that. The basic movement pattern you can duplicate if you move your hand in rather large arcs. You can experiment with that. There's one problem, though, namely that the rate of swing of a pendulum gets faster the shorter the string is. You can calculate that for the rate of movement in this picture, the string would have to be over 20 feet long. so to swing a pendulum and move the upper end of the string through considerable arcs when it's 20 feet long is not an easy proposition if you're going to do it that way. Furthermore, there are additional features of the way the thing wobbles and moves and so forth that you can't duplicate with the pendulum. You'd have to have some other strings attached in order to get those movement features. So anyway, that's just some observations on the question of hoaxing. Actually, photographic evidence is the weakest type of evidence due to the possibility of faking of photographic evidence. Yeah, briefly. I don't think it was spinning around an axis, but it does some movement like this that is unusual also. If you swing something with a pendulum, flying machines that they couldn't identify. And there have been reports of UFOs that crashed and wreckage that was recovered. Now this may seem like a really remarkable claim, because if a UFO crashed and left wreckage, you'd think that would be very strong evidence. But the claim is also made that the military people have recovered all that wreckage and are keeping the whole thing secret. This is a whole subject about which a great deal has been written. It sounds at first glance like a very fantastic sort of story, but in fact there's a lot of evidence indicating that such things really have happened. I'm going to play here just a brief tape in which a former military officer is giving testimony about how he was involved in the recovery of unusual wreckage in New Mexico. This is the Roswell, New Mexico crash. Yeah? He was testifying, I think, to Stanton Friedman, who is a fellow who has been investigating UFOs for many years.
Was there no kind of court of law or legal deposition or anything like that?
You see him on the camera. So you see his face. It can definitely be shown that that was that man, and he is talking. So unless you say that some actor was cleverly duplicating him and that he never complained about that, then you'd have to agree that this is his testimony. He was a major in U.S. Army Air Force Intelligence in the 509th Bomber Wing. This was back in the late 1940s, based in Roswell, New Mexico. So he's an authentic person. I would think that if they're faking him, then surely that would have been exposed. So not only has this man testified, but they have testimony that is videotaped that I've seen personally of about 15 other people who give corroborating testimony regarding this particular event. And they have transcribed testimony of quite a number of other people. So it's a case which is actually quite remarkable for the amount of evidence that is actually behind it, if you consider what a fantastic claim is being made. Let's see if this works.
They were astonished to find the vast amount of wreckage. One thing I'm certain of,
this is the man.
All our activities, it was not a weather balloon, nor an aircraft, nor a missile. It was something else for which we didn't know what it was. It was just fragments strewn all over this area, an area about 3/4 of a mile long and 700 feet wide. So we proceeded to pick up the parts. A lot of full members with symbols that the mere call of hieroglyphics, because I could not interpret them, could not be read. It was just like symbols from something that meant something. These little members could not be broken, could not be burned. I even tried to burn that, would not burn. See, that way is nothing. It's not as thick as a tinfoil or a pack of cigarettes. See, that's right, the bend is done. See, it will not bend. See, we did all we could to bend it, it would not bend. See, we even tried making a dent in it with a 15-pound sledgehammer. See, there's still no dent in it.
story of how the military suppresses this thing.
They wanted me to tell them about it, and I couldn't say anything. And when the general came in, he told me not to say anything, that he would have it.
The reason that this story has been...
Okay. So, this is a very elaborate story, but basically what happened was that initially newspaper stories went out announcing the discovery of the flying saucer. And then the next day, a press conference was held in which pieces of a weather balloon were shown. That's what you saw in the photographs there of the general holding up this thing that looked like tinfoil. And they said, it's just a weather balloon. And that was the end of the story. As you could see, the man testifying, that's this Major Jesse Marcel, was quite old. He was testifying just recently. It seems that many of these people, as they got old, decided that they would reveal the story before they passed on. So there's a great deal of material along these lines. Now I'm going to show you another thing here on a different line. This is highly scientific. In France, there's a study group sponsored by the government with a long French name. The initials for it are GEPAN, GEPAN. But it's a scientific study group for studying UFOs. So one famous case that they studied occurred in a place in France called Trans-en-Provence. Basically what happened was that there was a farmer there who was out in his fields one day, and he saw this disc-shaped object come flying through the air and land in his field. And it was there for about 2 or 3 minutes, he said. He was just staring at the thing. And then it took off. And that's all that happened. So when he went to the spot, he found that the earth had been dented in and blackened. So there was a very noticeable mark there, and all the plants where the thing landed had been burned. So he went to his neighbors, and they came and saw it, and they called the police, and eventually the study group was brought in. So the people involved with this study group were highly placed scientists in France, and they did a biochemical investigation of the area where this indentation formed. And they observed all kinds of strange biochemical changes in the plant that varied as a function of distance from the center of this mark. So they had quite elaborate investigations. So I have a small film clip here in which you see one of the scientists giving some testimony. So we'll try this one.
Samples of herbicide in the soil, no traces of anything.
This is just an actor here.
Someone wanted to create me. It would need more years of study than you and I have together. And they'd also have to have a greater knowledge of toxic compounds than exist anywhere.
I cut in a little bit more than I wanted to, but yep, it's okay.
The lab results were astounding. Based on the way the ground was impacted, whatever had landed that day in Renato's garden weighed 3.5 to 5 tons and it heated the soil to an extreme temperature of 1100 to 1500 degrees Fahrenheit.
a real man.
That in time and in distance, all the biochemical findings are consistent with the description given by the witness. And it is probably the first time in the world, to my knowledge, that such a complete set of data has been obtained on such cases of UFO landings.
En effet, nous étions, in effect, we were in the presence of an unidentified phenomenon which had been witnessed and that had left traces in the soil and surrounding the environment. In conclusion, after the case in Franc-en-Provence, one cannot have the same perception about the UFO phenomenon, for one can no longer debate whether or not it exists. One cannot say, do you believe in UFOs, or don't you believe in UFOs? For now we are aware of phenomena which we cannot control.
So, okay. So that case, by the way, let's see, did I bring it? I don't know if I... Let's see. Yeah, I got it. In case anyone wants to know, here's a scientific paper on the details of that case, written by the second guy who spoke in French, Velasco, wrote this paper. Gives all the details of the analysis and so forth. So these kinds of things are going on. So what I'm going to do a little bit later on is now talk about, or actually I guess I'll start that now, is talk about sightings or encounters with living beings connected with UFOs. So thus far I've shown some indications of the craft that are reported, at least they seem to be craft, that's how people interpret these phenomena. Of course, this Velasco, by the way, never says anything like that. He just says, an unknown phenomenon. So, he's being very scientific. So, in any case, since the 1940s, people have reported meeting strange-looking beings in connection with UFOs. Now, it was only in the 1960s, in fact, the late 1960s, that this became acceptable for discussion, even among people who study UFOs, what to speak of anyone else. Back in the 50s and 40s, even people who studied UFOs thought that it was just crazy when people reported seeing these little men. The beings that people report seeing typically have basically human form. There are different basic types of beings described. One type consists of beings that are quite short, with very large heads. They're said to have very large eyes, but the other features of the face are somewhat vestigial. The mouth is very small. It's described as being like a slit, usually. The nose is undeveloped and so forth. But at the same time, they do have a mouth, they do have a nose. They have all the basic human features. It's just that the proportions are unusual from our point of view. So this is one basic type of entity which is reported. They wear clothes. Very often they're described as wearing one-piece suits. In other cases, though, they're described as wearing rather outlandish outfits with funny collars and insignia with serpents and things like that. So, in some cases, they've been known to wear capes and jeweled pendants. Right. So, in any case, there are other types of beings described also. There are tall beings described that are said to look quite beautiful and have unusual eyes. The eyes are usually described as being slanted and sometimes as being pink in color. In other cases, the eyes are described as having cat-like pupils, vertical slit pupils.
And beautiful.
No, there's another category still. These tend to be short, uglier looking ones. But they have...
Pardon me? These are the proverbial little green men.
Well, very few of them are described as dreams. One or two reports are like that. Basically, their skin complexion is described as being grayish very often. Very often it's pointed out also that they don't have hair, typically, these short ones, that is. And they don't seem to have veins or anything like that. It's very unusual looking. So, in any case, these were being reported way back in the late 40s. Yeah?
What percentage are handsome or beautiful, as you're saying, in comparison to the ones I've only heard of being beautiful?
It's hard to say what the percentage is because you have sampling errors. It's a question of how many things get reported and what reports people select out in order to present to the public. Because of this kind of problem, it's difficult to get a real idea of the proportions of different kinds of sightings. I think you have to accumulate a lot of data before you can really get a feel for that. So, as I was saying, in the 40s and 50s, this data was mainly censored. For example, the U.S. Air Force ran this Project Blue Book for investigating UFOs for many years, but they just automatically threw any of these entity reports into what they called the crackpot file, which is circular and is sitting next to your desk. However, in the starting in 1961, there was a famous case of Betty and Barney Hill. This was a biracial couple who were traveling home from a vacation trip through New Hampshire. It was about midnight because they were very, very late getting home, traveling at night. So they maintained that a UFO came down, and they had this experience of seeing entities on the UFO, and they got in their car and drove off in a state of fear. And the next thing they knew, they were about a couple hundred miles down the road without any memory of what had happened in the interval. And at first they didn't think too much about it. When they got home, they found that it was they were a couple hours late and they couldn't account for that missing period of time. But they began having nightmares, and Barney Hill began developing ulcers. And so they finally went to a psychiatrist to try and figure out what went wrong, to a Dr. Simon in Boston. So the psychiatrist used hypnotherapy to try and recover any memories that they may have had of some traumatic experience that may have been the cause of their problem. So these accounts came out of what later became a classical UFO abduction. That is to say, they remembered that they were driving along in their car. For some reason, they pulled off the main road and went up a narrow road out into the woods, even though they had no reason to do it. When they got to the end of the road, this UFO was parked there. These strange little men surrounded their car, took them out of the car, onto the UFO, and subjected them to a kind of medical examination, which involved a whole series of different procedures, and then took them back. So that was their story. That was the first famous story of this kind of thing. Since then, there have been many stories like that. So I brought as one exhibit, just to talk a little bit about this. This is a write-up that one man made. This isn't published. This is privately circulated. He's spoken about this in public lectures, however. So I attended a lecture that he gave, and then I talked with him later on for about a good hour. So I had personal experience with what this man was like, what sort of person he was. So this fellow, his name is John Salter. He's a sociology professor at University of North Dakota. And also, he was involved in the civil rights movement with Martin Luther King and in other social justice type causes for many years. So that's his background. So I talked with him for some time, and he's a very level-headed, practical sort of person. He's not some kind of nut. And his story was that he and his son were traveling to Mississippi from North Dakota, and for some reason they went off into some backcountry roads. They couldn't quite figure out why they did it, and they had a time lapse. That is, they suddenly found that it was several hours later and they were several hundred miles down the road and they didn't know what had happened. So there again, there was one of these abduction type experiences. They said that, well, what happened was later on the man remembered the event, and he, if everyone is, I don't know, I kind of lose my train of thought when everyone's getting up and down and doing everything. So, in any case, so in this case also, he reported that later on he spontaneously remembered, without the aid of hypnosis in this case, that they had gone down this little dirt road into the woods. Some little men stopped them and took them out of their car, took them down a path into a clearing in the woods, and this UFO was parked there, and they were taken on board and given the examination and so on and so forth. So that's an example of the kind of testimony that is there. So what I want to do right now is say a little bit about the relevance of the reports people make of these entities to the Vedic literature. So it turns out that the features that people ascribe to these entities are all described within the Bhagavatam. So I'm going to give a series of examples here indicating this kind of thing. I have these in a sort of random order. One feature is quite unusual. Well, just to start with something a little less unusual, the beings float through the air. This is typically described. For example, here's the testimony of a Air Force sergeant named Charles Moody. Now, he was part of the U.S. Air Force Human Reliability Program, and the point was made that candidates for this elite group are carefully screened by psychiatrists for emotional disorders. So just to become a member of that group, you had to be screened by psychiatrists and so forth. So there's a whole elaborate story that he has, but the key point was the following thing. He said, it's going to sound ridiculous, and I hope nobody sends me a straitjacket, but these beings did not walk, they glided. So this is one example. It's a very standard thing that these beings can float through the air. But that is a Vedic phenomenon also. It's a very standard thing for different personalities in the Bhagavatam to float through the air by virtue of Lagima City. So that's an example. Now, there's more involved than just floating through the air. It's typically described that these beings can go through walls, which it seems a little bit unusual. So, in other words, you might be sitting here in this room, and then this fellow comes through the wall. That would be a bit shocking if that happened. So, there are many accounts like that, however.
When he comes to the wall, does the wall move around when he walks through?
Well, there are not too many descriptions of exactly what happens. I know of one case where it's described that they seem sort of vaporous as they come through, and then they seem to solidify once they're within the room. But I don't know too much in the way of details there. But the main thing is a lot of people report these things. Now, having mentioned such an outrageous point, I should go back a little and discuss the psychological profiles of some of these people. I have also documentation, for example, of a blind study that was done by a psychologist named Elizabeth Slater on 9 people reporting these kinds of experiences. Now, they were sent to her with no mention of any that they had anything to do with UFO experiences. And they were told not to tell her anything about them. So as far as she knew, these people were being sent to her for psychological evaluation for some reason. So she did a study with all kinds of tests and so forth. She concluded the people were completely sane. There was no trace of psychosis or schizophrenia, nor epilepsy, nor any of these various disorders that could cause a person to hallucinate. They did show signs of post-traumatic stress syndrome, which is something connected with rape victims, Vietnam veterans, and other people who've been through a traumatic experience. So that was the profile. So then she was told, well, what these people have in common is that each one of them was captured by strange beings and carried on board a UFO. So, and she was astonished by that, because she said that obviously you would think that she had some amazing psychological jargon, but hysteroid characters, subject to fugue states, and dissociative, etc., etc. Only such people would tell a story like that, you would think. But they weren't like that. So anyway, that's there. So there are examples of the entities floating through walls. Now I'll make it a little bit worse. People have testified that the entities have picked them up and carried them through the wall. Now, what is going on there? There's a lot of testimony like that. I could give you a whole list of cases. So, pardon me? I could give you 10 very easily. With some scraping, I could get up to 50 on that. So anyway, this also is a Vedic phenomenon. Now, we find this in the Krishna book, amongst other places. And Srila Prabhupada has a very disarming way of talking about it, because he talks about flying through outer space. For example, you know the story of Usha and Aniruddha. So in that story, actually it's an amazing psychical story. Usha has this dream of this beautiful young man who she feels very attracted to. And of course she is a princess who is in the inner chambers of Banasura's palace, so she's very protected. So she has a friend, though, Chitraleka, who's a mystic yogini. So anyway, Chitraleka uses a pretty psychical method to try and figure out who the young man is. And he turns out to be Aniruddha, Prajumna's son. So Chitraleka flies through outer space to Dwarka, picks up Aniruddha, who's sleeping in his bed, doesn't awaken him, carries him through outer space back to Sonitapura, where Banasura's palace is, right into the very inner quarters where Usha is sequestered, and then they have a whole affair together. So this involves traveling through walls and traveling through the air even in such a way that it doesn't wake up Aniruddha. And the whole idea of traveling through outer space, actually what that means is traveling through the ether. And the basic idea there is that everywhere where there is matter, there is also ether. It's right there. It is possible to just interact with the ether so that you don't interact with the matter that's there. Then you can go right through walls or whatever it may be, traveling through the ether, and then you can come back into your normal state and interact with matter in the normal way. So that is a Vedic thing. So that you find with the UFO reports and the Vedic literature. Now, another thing is invisibility. Now, apart from this matter of being able to travel through a wall or something like that, the UFOs give evidence that they can become invisible. And also the entities connected with them can become invisible, even though they're still there. Now, an example of that, there was a case of a man named Maurice Massé, just to give one example. This, again, was a French case. Massé was a farmer. He was growing lavender, so he had a big field of it. So this UFO came down, and a little man got out. The man levitated into the air, He was one of these big-headed guys with the large eyes and so forth. Then he got back in his UFO. The UFO moved a few feet and vanished from sight. He just blinked out. Suddenly it wasn't there. This was broad daylight, so he could just see it wasn't there anymore. But the track that it left as it flew continued across his field for about 400 feet. So, because the lavender crop was pushed down, leaving a track for about 400 feet. So the indication is that the UFO blinked out. It became invisible, but it was still there moving and producing wind. So that's also a Vedic thing. This is known as antardhana. So one nice example of that is in the case of Krishna's battle with the Salva, the airplane of Salva. Of course, you know that story from Krishna book, and that's in the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Of course, briefly, the story is that Salva acquired this airplane. Srila Prabhupada calls it an airplane, but actually, it's not like any airplane that you normally see. It's described that it could appear and disappear. Sometimes multiple images of it would appear. That is, there seem to be several of them in the sky. Other times you'd see it hovering somewhere, and so on and so forth. In one part of the description in Mahabharata of Krishna's battle with the Soba, it says that the Danava soldiers on the Soba vehicle were laughing and shouting all kinds of insults at Krishna in harsh voices. And it also said they were very disheveled looking. So, and then the whole thing vanished from sight. It disappeared, but you could still hear them shouting all these. All the Danava soldiers were slain upon the Soba. So, anyway, that's invisibility. Let's see. Now, of course, another thing is telepathy. Telepathic communication is a very standard thing in Vedic literature. In fact, the Bhagavad Gita is even communicated that way to Sanjaya by the mercy of Vyasadeva. So, in these UFO cases, the beings very often communicate with the humans that they contact, but in almost every case it is said that this is telepathic. There are a few cases where it is said that ordinary vocal language was used and a translating machine was used. There are a few cases like that. But generally speaking, telepathy is used. Now another aspect of this, which I've already briefly mentioned, is the idea of control through hypnotic power. This is a Vedic thing. There is what is called the Vasita Siddhi, which is, Srila Prabhupada describes that in the Nectar of Devotion as being a power of hypnosis, which you can use to control a person and bewilder them in various ways. So, as I mentioned, in these UFO abduction cases, typically what happens is the person will be guided to some remote spot where the actual encounter takes place. And they don't understand why they went there. They just feel impelled to go out and drive to some particular place. So, it's interesting that apparently people can do that also. I did some research on that. Yeah, people can cause a person to go and travel to a certain spot. There are two cases of research along those lines that I know of. One was in Russia in about the 1930s. There was a professor named Vasilyev who did research on remote hypnosis. He was able to show that you could influence the person in Leningrad from the city of Sevastopol. Leningrad is up near the Baltic Sea, and Sevastopol is down near the Black Sea. So someone in Sevastopol could give a hypnotic command to someone in Leningrad to go to sleep. And they had their watches synchronized, and people were observing and so forth. And they found that you could give good statistical evidence that it worked. In other words, measure when the person went to sleep and when the command was given and so forth. So So these studies were done with all kinds of statistical protocols and so forth. But one that's more interesting from a sort of storytelling viewpoint is the case in France, in which some psychical researchers were trying this. So a Dr. Guibert, this was in Le Havre, France, decided that he would call a certain woman who was a patient of his to his home hypnotically. So it was agreed that he would do this at a certain time, and the woman was not told anything about this plan. But the other scientists who were involved with this hid out near her home in order to see what would happen. So sure enough, at the designated time when he began giving commands for her to come to his place, she, in a sort of somnambulistic fashion, walked out of her home and started sort of going down the street in an unsteady fashion as though she was sleepwalking. And in due course of time, she went to his place. So that's an example. So there's this Vasita city. That's an element of the UFO cases, but also there's even indications that human beings can do this kind of thing. So, let's see. Various items. I thought I would also mention the case of the abduction of Duryodhana. Let's see, how are we doing for time here? So, on the subject of abduction, it's interesting, in the Mahabharata, it's described that King Duryodhana at a certain point was abducted. Briefly, the story there is that he had decided to commit suicide by fasting unto death. He had become quite disturbed. What happened was that he had gone to the Pandavas, who were in exile, in order to humiliate them. And so his idea was he would parade in front of them with all his finery, and they were there in the forest wearing bark clothes and so forth. And thus he would totally lord it over them. So on the way there, he ran into a group of Gandharvas, which were occupying a certain section of the forest, and they wouldn't let him through. So he was accustomed to having his way. So he said, all right, I'm coming through anyway. So a big battle took place, and the Gandharvas completely defeated Duryodhana and Karna and so forth. They were just totally beaten by the superior forces of the Gandharvas. So Duryodhana was captured by the Gandharvas. So the news came to the Pandavas, and immediately Bhima said, great, serves the guy right. At last he's getting what he deserves. And then Yudhisthira spoke up, and you can imagine what he said. He said, well, no, we must save Duryodhana. It is our duty, because he is a human being. He's been captured by these non-humans. So according to the law of Dharma, it is our duty to come to his aid. Besides, he's a family member. So Arjuna, as it happened, had political pull with the Gandharvas due to the fact that his father was Indra, which is very helpful for political pull. So he spoke to the Gandharva chieftains, and Duryodhana was released. But he was totally humiliated by this. Here his enemy had arranged for his release. So he decided he would fast unto death. So meanwhile, down in Patala Loka, the Danavas got wind of this, and they sent a mysterious woman named Kritya to get Duryodhana and take him to Patala Loka. So sure enough, Kritya appeared before Duryodhana, grabbed a hold of him, and carried him to Patala Loka. Now this is another example of carrying a body through matter, because to go to Patala Loka, you go through the earth. So he was then brought into the presence of the Danavas, and they talked things over with him. And they explained that they had actually engineered his body. They were involved in his very birth. Actually, he was part of a very long-term plan that they had to take over the world. In fact, they specifically mentioned that they had arranged for the upper part of his body to be as hard as diamonds and to be invulnerable to any weapon. However, they had not arranged this for the lower part of his body. So, in any case, There's an interesting feature of this involving mind control, which I thought was interesting. This is how the Donovas described what would happen in the Battle of Kurukshetra. Mind control would be used in order to win the battle. They said, other Asuras will take possession of Bhishma, Drona, Kripa, and the others, and possessed by them, they will fight your enemies ruthlessly. When they engage in battle, best of the Kurus, they will give no quarter to either sons or brothers, parents or relatives, students or kinsmen, the young or the old. Pitiless, possessed by the Donovas, their inner souls overwhelmed, they will battle their relations and cast all love far off. Gleefully, their minds darkened, the tiger-like men, befuddled with ignorance, will say to each other, you will not escape from me with your life. So this was the idea. The Donovas would control the minds of Bhishma and Kripa and so forth and turn them against the Pandavas. So, okay. Let's see, what do we have next here? Oh, really?
The same thing was done by the boss. He created that demon woman, a leash.
Yeah?
They even put it in the picture.
Really?
Yes. I think it was a plan for the female.
That's interesting. Yes, in other words, if you have an evil errand to perform, you summon one of these entities, and they'll do it for you. Well, yeah, they summoned her up. Well, I'll have to tell you a Whitley Strieber story. Because he has the same story. Let me see, I got that here someplace. Oh, here it is. Okay. This is what he reported. Now, I don't know if you read about Kritya, but he said that he woke up in the dark of night, and this strange female being was there. Not too human-looking, with the big eyes and the spindly limbs and the whole thing. But anyway, she controlled his movements and floated him out of the room, he said. He said, if I walked, everything was normal, but if I stopped, I began to float along. I could feel her pushing from behind. I had no control over my direction. I was not moving, I was being moved. So that's how he described the experience. So, according to his story, he was moved through the rooms of his house. So, it seemed normal, it looked like the regular rooms. He was floating along until they came to the door of his house. Then he said, do I have that here? Oh yeah, here it is. Now at the door he said, we moved again, and this time I entered a profoundly different situation. No longer could I see normally. There was a glittering blackness before me. I could still feel Sadie in my arms. He picked up his cat from the sofa for reality testing, he said, in order to prove this wasn't a dream. So he grabbed his cat. So I could still feel Sadie in my arms, and I was very glad for her companionship. The next thing I knew, I was standing in a room, and he said there were three other beings in the room, an ordinary-looking woman, a 6'6" or taller blonde man, and someone with a ridiculous toupee who looked like something from another world wearing the clothes of the 40s. The clothes of the 1940s. Anyway, that was his account. But the basic theme there, actually this comes up fairly often, that a strange-looking female entity will come and take the person and carry them off. And then the question is, how do they know that they're female? They say, well, it just sort of feels as though the quality of the person was female. They can't really tell, really, from the appearance. So, let's see. Oh, well, here's another Vedic parallel that I thought was kind of interesting. In this one, there's something called the Oz effect that is associated with UFO encounters. And this is when the encounter begins, everything becomes quiet, mysteriously. The crickets stop chirping, the leaves stop rustling. It's like there's a deathly stillness. So this comes up in one report after another. There are many different examples of it. So you find the same thing in Vedic literature. For example, when Ravana came to kidnap Sita, it's described in the Ramayana that the leaves stopped rustling, the birds stopped chirping, the river Godavari, or Godavari, stopped. You couldn't hear the rippling sound anymore, it became silent, and so forth. So there are different examples like that. So, okay, little interlude here. Where am I? Okay. Just to give you another example of the kind of testimony that exists.
Feeling that this might compromise the privacy and security of themselves.
Fellow who didn't want to be publicly
known. A noted television and radio columnist who took the photograph. After a lengthy discussion, Janishi assures the witness that his identity will be closed.
You want to see them?
Yeah. Those pictures were taken, some by the gentleman you're talking about, and some by his mother, were they not?
Just by him. By him and his wife. I don't know which one of them. His mother was, I think, his or her mother was kind of old, and she was having to cover her picture.
Did they ever see the spacecraft on or near the ground?
Well, just what I was talking about.
Just over there.
Yeah, just flying. You know, there's a lot of pictures here. As far as I know, no one has ever seen these photographs except the people I've described. Here is like this one's flying directly over the house.
Mm-hmm.
Right over the house. Here it is with the top of the scapula raised. He said that scapula went up and down top.
Changed elevation. Sometimes it was higher and sometimes.
Well, you can see in this one, there's no top to the thing. This is going over the house also. This is the same photograph, but it's further over the house. See, this is going over the house?
Uh-huh.
He took another picture that got over the house.
That's interesting.
And then as it went out in the field, it elevated this little thing on top of bubble on top.
That accounts for some of the changing shapes that we get reported.
I see. And here's one again in the open field, just over a cornfield, way out over the trees. He said the motion pictures are extremely good.
But
because he got to go over the house, in the woods, and out the field, and all that kind of stuff. Said it was tremendous pictures.
Could
you give us his telephone number again and let us call me?
I won't unless I call him. I'm not approached on with you.
We'll pay for the call if you call him and ask him if he will talk to us. We'll give him a control name. We won't reveal his identity or location. We can promise all those things and give proof of
them. These are just photographs that you can take pictures of.
Like this is one that's going in the trees and going a little further, so on and so forth. And because of his wife, I don't feel like he'll ever do anything as long as he lives.
Mm-hmm.
Because she is still terrifying.
Yeah.
So, and there's a very nice people. Mm-hmm. And they're very rich people. Okay, so it wasn't a case where they couldn't protect her, spend her money, and she couldn't, but they didn't seem to bother. They got scared. He said, you know, eventually, these people are going to contact you. He says, if you start this thing up, they're going to contact you. He says, and I know what I'm talking about. I've talked to other people who've been through this thing. He says, that's the reason we're totally silent. He says, so if you want all the publicity and all the headaches you may ever get, you start revealing it. And now I don't know what I should listen to.
That's one case. Let's see what we got.
I was awake and by the sound, I thought it was a helicopter.
Another
right
example.
Here in the backyard. I woke up and the whole entire inside of my house was lit up real bright, outside real bright. So I finally got to the window and bedroom window and looked out and didn't see any crash of a helicopter. The first thing I seen was just the most perfect flying saucers you ever see. And I never believed in them, but I've seen that one. I believe in them now. But it was over the whole structure of these pine trees here. Right here is up. It's about 70 foot in circumference, approximately two stories high. I viewed it for approximately 3 minutes. But I had a broke leg, and I grabbed one of my crutches and finally hit my wife in the leg and got her awake, and she got to the window, and she said, oh my gosh, how beautiful. So it was sitting there hovering over these pine trees, and as it was hovering over the trees, it was still floating, just up and down motion, clockwise, just like that. And when it got ready to leave, it just turned up, tipped up on the edge, and just went off like a streak of light. The saucer landed in his front yard, came down in his front yard. They went to his house, and he drew this sketch
here.
And about an hour and a half later, the Easley Sheriff's Department called me and asked, could they come down and me draw a sketch of the saucer that was here in the backyard?
Mm-hmm.
I said, sure. So they came down, across an hour and a half. I drew this sketch here of the saucer.
Yeah.
And not even seeing this, they... Mm-hmm. Like I drew mine, they compared it, and you see how close they are.
Right.
They didn't even, I didn't even know that they had a sketch that he
drew. Yeah, they didn't know anyone else had seen it.
Didn't even know anyone else had seen it.
Right.
The UFO bore a striking route. Oh.
Yeah? Seven-foot grasshoppers. Well,
do you have any encounters like that?
Some of the descriptions of these beings say that they look exceedingly emaciated, so people compare them to insects. The basic account that you get is that you have a human form, but the arms and legs are very stick-like in many cases. That's one aspect. Yeah?
How about, like, when you
start talking
about
it, well, we won't get into the biz here. No, anyway, we're doing this for Krishna consciousness. So, in any case, let's see. See where I was here. The basic point that I was getting at is the nature of the entities, the kinds of powers that they exhibit, the traits that they have, and so forth, have parallels in the Vedic literature in terms of the nature of the living beings that are described, the kinds of powers they have, or cities, and so on and so forth. So there are considerable parallels there. I'll mention one other parallel that I always thought was kind of interesting. This is the creation of illusory animal forms. That is connected also with UFOs. Now, one case I have in the UFO domain would be a case of a girl given the pseudonym of Virginia Horton, not her real name, who was lured through the woods by a deer that she said was very fascinating. It was like a conscious deer. And later on, under hypnosis, it was revealed that she had a UFO encounter out in the woods. Typical thing with different entities and so forth. So I thought that was interesting if you consider the story, for example, in the Ramayana of the deer which lures Lakshman and Lord Ramachandra away from Sita. In that case, of course, Marichi, the Rakshasa, was assuming the form of a deer. But significantly, when he was shot by Lord Ramachandra, the dead body that wound up there was that of the Rakshasa. So in that case, that was an illusory form that he was projecting, and as soon as he died, he went back to his normal form. Some of the demons in Krishna's pastimes, however, did a different thing. They actually assumed a physical form, and then when they died, the dead body that was left was of that physical form. For example, Lagasura, his body was left drying up for a year, actually. So there seemed to be two different ways of doing it. But in any case, the projection of illusory forms is another thing that you find in the UFO phenomena. So Let's see. There are two additional areas to discuss. There's the heavy negative material, and then there's the more positive, encouraging material. Let's see. I guess, to be perfectly honest, I should go into some of the heavy negative material also. So, there are cases in which, in these UFO encounters, people are quite thoroughly traumatized, and there have been cases where people are attacked, it would appear, with some kind of weapons. Very often, they get zapped with a beam of light. For example, in Brazil, this seems to be more common than in this country. But there are cases there. For example, there's a case of a Raimundo Souza, I believe was his name. He was a fellow who used to go hunting out in the forest, back when they still had forests in Brazil. And so the technique of hunting was interesting, because what they would do is set up a hammock up in a tree, and they'd have a flashlight and a rifle. When a deer came along, they'd shine the flashlight in its eyes, and the deer would freeze. That's what it does in the dark when a flashlight is in, and then they'd shoot it with a rifle. So it's interesting that these same hunters are being hunted, apparently, by a similar technique. What happens is that this object comes flying over. The local word for them is a chupa. So the object flies over and shines a very bright light at them, and then zaps them with a beam. And there have been deaths associated with this. It's not completely clear if the cause of death is directly the beam that strikes the person. It seems in some cases the person dies of a heart attack at the point when he's struck by the beam. But of course, that may be due to shock of that experience. But in any case, deaths have been reported. This Raimundo Souza died. That was witnessed by his hunting companion. A rather well-attested case of something similar is this Travis Walton case that occurred in Arizona. There were some men doing woodcutting out in the forest, and they testified that they were going home from work on this road through the woods. They saw this UFO hovering, glowing thing hovering in the air. One of them, named Travis Walton, got out of their truck and walked towards it out of curiosity. And the others were frightened, and they stayed in the truck and were shouting at him, you know, don't go near that thing. So he went right up to it, and suddenly he was struck by a bluish beam of light. He didn't know that himself. In his experience, suddenly he just was knocked out. But the other men testified that this bluish beam of light came out of the craft, hit him in the chest, and knocked him over for several feet, in fact. So they were scared at that point, and they went off. They drove off very fast. And then they began to think, well, wait a minute, we've abandoned him, and what could be happening? He could be laying there dying or something. So they got up their courage and drove back to the site, but nothing was there. They couldn't find him or anything. So in due course, they contacted the sheriff. There was a big police search that went on for 5 days. And they couldn't find any trace of the body. And the men were suspected of murder. The idea came up that, well, they killed the guy, and this was their story. Somewhat strange story. So they were given a polygraph lie detector test, and one man was judged to be too agitated to take the test. The others passed the test. That is, as far as that test is concerned, they were telling the truth as they understood it. That's always the thing to keep in mind about these tests. It doesn't prove that the person is telling the truth. It gives you evidence suggesting strongly that he's telling the truth as he believes it. Because the test really measures how anxious you are about what you're saying. The idea being, if you're deliberately lying, it's betrayed by some physical symptoms that they can measure. So it was considered unusual in the case of a phony story for 5 men who I think took the test to pass it. So there's pretty strong testimony that event did occur. In that case, Travis Walton appeared after 5 days. He just came out of the forest area to a phone booth, called up his brother, and his story was that he awakened the consciousness on board the UFO. In other words, he remembered walking towards it, seeing it, and then suddenly, with great pain, he awoke to consciousness and he was in the UFO, and these strange-looking entities were standing around him, and they had some kind of apparatus on his chest. So then he gave a whole story of what happened on the UFO. But his experience there lasted for about an hour and a half, and the rest of the 5 days was not accounted for. And to my knowledge, he never did find out what happened during the rest of the time. So anyway, that's another case of violence. What I thought I would do, see if we have some time, I have here a section of a videotape which is testimony under hypnosis of a lady who observed a cattle mutilation taking place on board a UFO. Now, cattle mutilation is another whole topic that one could discuss, but this has been happening at regular intervals in the United States and other countries. What happens is that farm animals such as cows and horses are found dead in the fields with organs cut out of them with surgical precision. Very often it's the genitals, or one eye will be removed, or the heart will be removed. And they observe that the cuts show signs of high temperature. If you look at the flesh under a microscope, there's signs of burning along the cut, which is very precise. And also, typically there's no blood found in the bodies of the animals. And, to make it more interesting, the animal may be found in an area of soft ground where you'd expect tracks leading up to it and away from it if somebody came up to the animal to do this kind of thing, but there are no tracks. So these are mysterious cases. People have connected numerous, thousands of cases. And I could show you dozens of newspaper clippings, you know, about this subject.
Do they have any explanation on the Jack and Ripper doctor?
Well, the explanations people have offered is, the standard explanation you'll hear is that, well, predators do it, like, well, coyotes, but coyotes don't do that.
Laser surgery?
No laser surgery from coyotes. The next one is satanic cults. Satanic cults may do some things like that, for all you know, but you would think that if this was being done by human beings, then some of them would have been apprehended by now, and if they were apprehended and brought to trial for doing this, brought to trial for such a thing. So why would the police turn a blind eye to that kind of activity? I can see with drug smuggling, but this is another thing. Pardon me? Yeah, why the military would kill cows on farmers' property is another.
I heard they went up to residential neighborhoods in Panama during that day, and they were using high-powered radios for cutting cars in half.
Well, I don't know. Maybe they did, but that's military operation. When you invade a country, you do things like that. But anyway, but in Colorado, it's another thing. So I have testimony here of a woman describing seeing a calf being cut up on board a UFO. So that is a, I'll just play a little bit of it. Just for the, yeah? That's been said. I researched that, and it's phony. It's due to misquoting the work of a certain man named Womack, who does study of DNA of cattle. It's been reported that cattle DNA and human DNA are very similar. But I looked up his papers and corresponded with him, and he said he's totally been misrepresented about that, and it's not true at all. So that's another aspect.
She and her mother, daughter Cindy, and brother and sister-in-law watched the strange, bright light hover in the sky. After that night, she suffered terrible headaches and anxiety. In 1978, she underwent one hypnosis session which brought out part of her unusual experience, but not all of it. She also had several psychiatric and personality evaluations, all with results in the normal human behavior range. The second hypnosis session with Dr. Sprinkle occurred on March 13, 1980.
Now you're standing outside your car. Now you're looking up. You can describe your impressions. What are your impressions?
It's like a spotlight that's shining down the back of my car. And it's like it has substance to it. I can see an animal being taken up in this. I can see it squirming and trying to get free. And it's like it's being sucked up. It's taken into some sort of chamber. It's a little round, tiny room. And I get nauseated at watching how they excise parts.
You see the animal being cut up?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. How is it being cut up?
The tissue is laid out flat and smooth, glistening. And the needles, there's needles in it. Or what appears to be that needles, but maybe probes, I don't know. But it has a tube connected to it. And the same thing with what appears to be testicles.
Is anybody else around you?
I feel the presence of other things, but I don't know what they are. I can't see them.
Okay, just let yourself focus on what is happening inside the crypt. Be aware of who is around you. It's okay. You'll be able to describe who is standing around you.
It appears to be two little men.
Two little men? Mm-hmm. How do they look?
Their hands are funny. They have long claw nails, like. They have very large eyes. They're very hypnotic. But they're so big that, and they don't blink. Their eyes do not blink. Some of them are different things. They were very snappy about their movements, and they knew exactly what they were doing, and I felt a little better because I, for some reason, they projected that it was necessary to see them.
At one point in the hypnosis session,
anyway, that's an example of that. So, let's see, we're doing on time here. So, in Vedic literature also, we have heavy negative phenomena described. Of course, that shouldn't be surprising to us because that's the basic theme of the Srimad Bhagavatam and the Mahabharata, is that demons were taking over the earth, and so Krishna came to rectify the situation. So the heavy negative aspect is there. Of course, that's what was going on with Duryodhana in that story that I mentioned. So, of course, the ultimate solution to that is to become Krishna conscious, because after all, it was Krishna who resolved the negative situation back then. And it is Krishna who can resolve all negative situations. By the way, many people who discuss this UFO phenomenon are very greatly disturbed by it. Disturbance is the general response of people who are serious about this. Here's what this Dr. Jacobs said, by the way, at the end of his book. He said, I am often asked how I would react if the entire abduction phenomenon should be proved to be the internally generated product of people's imaginations. If there are in reality no abductions and no aliens, and never have been, if that were true, I would weep with joy. I want to be wrong. This is what he writes. So, it looks like a pretty bleak picture when people investigate these things, and they find that it appears as though some kind of ghoulish entities are playing games with us, and we have no power to do anything about it. That's the impression that many of these researchers have. I'd say that's the predominant mood in many of these conferences in which the serious people discuss this. I'm not talking about the New Age type of presentation. So, ultimately, Krishna consciousness, I would suggest, has the actual answer for that, because the basic message, as I said, is that we're not actually all-powerful. There are powers, intelligent beings, and so forth, that we cannot control. That's described in the Vedic literature. But over everything, there's the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And if you become Krishna's devotee, then he takes care of you, and so forth. The basic message of Krishna consciousness. And as I mentioned earlier on, this fellow, Professor Matt, at the Harvard Medical School, is also bringing up ideas that, well, maybe the anima mundi has something in mind here that we should learn about, the soul of the world. So, that's the heavy negative side, which could get a great deal heavier. I'll end with another report here. This was from on the positive side. People have encounters of a positive, more spiritual nature. One of the best attested encounter phenomena of all time practically occurred in Fatima, a little town in Portugal, in 1917. Now, this was a visitation of the Virgin Mary. And one may say, well, that sounds like a Roman Catholic thing. And it was. The people were all Roman Catholics. But the basic story there is that three children would once every month see the Virgin Mary, or at least a woman that they took to be that, floating in the air, glowing effulgently, in this one little secluded place near the town of Fatima, which is way out in the country in rural Portugal. So this happened on the 13th of the month for several months in a row. And gradually, crowds of people began to assemble there. Only the children could see the lady herself. However, other people saw some rather interesting things. For example, this one man, Monsignor J. Quaresma, he said, to my surprise, I see clearly and distinctly a globe of light advancing from east to west, gliding slowly and majestically through the air. Suddenly, the globe with its extraordinary light vanished. But near it, the little girl of about 10 continues to cry joyfully, I still see it, I still see it. So apparently this globe would come, and the Virgin Mary apparently would come out of that. Yeah?
What about
Right. Right. So the testimony here gets considerably beyond that. Because what happens, of course, there are many confirming details and so on, but the real punchline of it is that the children, well, the one child, Lucia, asked this Virgin Mary, if that's who it was, please do a miracle so that the people can believe. So she said, okay, on the 13th of October, I will perform a miracle. So this was broadcast in advance, so everybody heard about it. That's the prediction. On the 13th of October, there will be a miracle. So 70,000 people showed up for it, it is estimated.
These are facts.
These are facts. It's well attested. It's in all the newspapers, and all kinds of people have given their personal testimony and so on and so forth, that this really happened. They estimate. I'm sure they didn't do a head count, but it's some kind of estimate. So it was terrible weather. It was sort of like New Vrindavan, I think. Mud everywhere. It was raining, drizzling. You can imagine 70,000 people churning the mud up out in the fields in the rural area. So anyway, they assembled there. The report is that suddenly what appeared to be the sun appeared in the sky. And for about a 10-minute period, it gave out colors of light of all different colors of the rainbow in sort of square patterns that flashed over the ground and over people and so on. So you look at the people next to you and they were turning now green, now violet, now red. And the whole landscape was lit up like this by this light coming out of what sort of looked like the sun. So this went on for some time. Then it began darting through the sky in zigzags. And finally, shooting out these colored lights. Now lots of people gave testimony that they were there and they saw it. And you can say, well, if that's mass hallucination, it's a pretty good one. Not quite like sort of seeing the Mickey Mouse in a cloud and saying, well, that, I saw Mickey Mouse. So anyway, finally, it looked as though the sun, because that's what they thought it was going to crash down on them. Suddenly it came down, became much bigger and brighter, and they felt it was going to crush them. People were falling on their knees and praying and screaming and all kinds of things. So, and then at that point, it shot up into the air, and then there was just the ordinary sun in the sky. And that was the end of the display. Now, key point here, even if you advance the mass hysteria phenomenon for that crowd of people, somehow, over an area of 600 square miles, so that would be like 20 by 30 miles, let's say. Non-attendees in surrounding communities, they saw it, and there were lots of reports from surrounding communities, and they described it in the same way. Beyond that, nobody saw it. And no university people reported it looking through telescopes or anything. So it seems that it was a local manifestation, but it was seen over quite a broad area in one locality, and lots of people reported it, and it had been predicted in advance. And that was in all the papers and everybody knew. So, interesting phenomenon. That was a more positive thing, though. One thing I wanted to mention as a curious little Vedic parallel there, when this glowing globe would show up that the people saw, they would say that it looked like rose petals would come showering down from the sky and they would vanish or dissolve just before they hit the ground. So this had a story of flowers falling from the sky, which is a standard Vedic thing, because there are so many reports of flowers from the sky. So I'll just show you one last little item. Just to finish things off. This shows a couple of things that were happening back in 1947.
States government has spent a lot of time and effort debunking UFOs, even to the point of turning the whole thing into a joke.
Of all the items in our stock catalog, there's only one which has a high velocity and low wind resistance of flying saucers. The cover of a GI trash can.
But some military people, like retired Marine Major Donald Keogh, spoke out, accusing the government of hiding what it knows about UFOs.
This is not an attack on the Air Force spokesman or the project spokesman. They are simply following orders to explain away all UFO sightings as quickly as possible when they become public and deny that UFOs really exist.
We have...
There was a guy denying it there. That was Secretary Brown of the Air Force. So anyway...
Well, yes, Secretary Brown was denying it.
Pardon me?
One guy was referring to Secretary Brown.
The fellow who was speaking there, I cut off Secretary Brown. I should have showed you some of what he said. The guy speaking was Major Kehoe. He was a famous personality in the 50s regarding UFOs. He went to the public and argued that the military is covering up the information concerning UFOs and so forth. There was all kinds of controversy going on. I think so. I haven't heard that he was died under mysterious circumstances. But that's 6 o'clock. Any comments or questions? Yeah.
I saw a book on Christian catalog that had a UFO thing, and it's the Christian tradition. There's traditions of some higher entities as well.
In Christian tradition?
The angels and archangels come down.
Well, yeah. I mean, it depends on what Christians you're talking about. You know, the traditional European Christians had angels and all kinds of things. Devils. So many different things. Yeah, you had? Yeah. Well, the basic thought that I have concerning this whole phenomenon, of course, I can't say definitely what is going to happen, obviously. But the what it serves to do is change people's consciousness, as far as I can see. Nothing overt is occurring. Obviously, it's not an invasion from outer space or anything like that. Even though this guy Jacobs in this book says we have been invaded, he's quite concerned about it. But this fellow Matt echoed another idea, namely that this is going to bring people to some idea of some anima mundi, which is in control of this planet and has some plan for it to keep us from messing it up and so forth. In any case, we live in a very materialistic period of time, but this kind of information can be used to help in spreading spiritual knowledge, which is the only reason that I've gotten into it. Yeah?
Perhaps you could show us, draw that, how you just simply walk on the journey. I just kind of to reduce our full pride.
Mm-hmm.
How would you think it's an avenue for spreading consciousness? Maybe you could walk us through it.
Well, I will. I began this discussion deliberately by quoting from a book which presents Vedic literature as fantasy and fairy tales. Now, let's be realistic. That's what most intelligent, educated people think, not only in this country, but in India. If you go to India, to the universities also, they think the same thing. So, I mean, I've talked to people. Mayavadi philosophy is fine. Brahman does not get in the way of science, you see. But Krishna lifting mountains and shape-changing demons and all that kind of thing definitely get in the way of science. So the whole point is, the modern scientific worldview accepted by rational, educated, sensible people of today kicks out Krishna consciousness across the board. So therefore, we must remain as a very small, isolated, sectarian group, as long as that is the prevailing situation. Now, empirically speaking, because we're talking here about science and empiricism, science is supposed to be based on data, evidence. Science cannot give you absolute conclusions about anything. It's all imperfect. It's all speculative. That's the nature of science. But people are believing in science today. They're getting their whole picture of the world from science. As I say, even in India, the intellectuals likewise are following science. They believe in the Big Bang. They believe in Darwin. They believe in dating Hastinapur to 800 BC and no earlier, and so many different things like that. So the point is, what is the world really like? So, based on empirical evidence, the world is really quite different from the world as presented in modern science. It is much more similar to the world as presented in the Bhagavatam. Now, the Bhagavatam describes that you have 400,000 human forms of life. Obviously, we don't hear about all of them in the Bhagavatam because it only has 18,000 verses. So you've got 400,000 forms of life. But we know generally about them, their mystic powers and so forth. So that is the world of the Bhagavatam. So what is the real world like? This kind of evidence, and other kinds, which, as I said, I had to discuss on other occasions, back up the worldview of the Bhagavatam. And they indicate that the worldview of modern science is seriously deficient. That's why the scientists kick out this kind of evidence. How are they going to account for beings that come through the walls and all that kind of thing? I mean, it doesn't fit into their world picture at all. But it does fit into the Bhagavatam world picture. And therefore it can be used to suggest to people we actually live in the world of the Vedic literature. And then ultimately, the solution to problems should be the kind of solution presented in the Vedic literature. At least that's a corollary we can suggest. That's only a suggestion, but people can see if that makes sense or not. The scientific method, as I mentioned before, is that we are the topmost beings, certainly within millions of light years of here, and we have to figure everything out on our own power. There's no God that's going to help us. And we can do it by our own power because we have the intelligence to manipulate matter and so forth. So if that's not true, then the basic devotional approach of the Srimad Bhagavatam becomes a much more viable alternative. And if the basic world picture of the Srimad Bhagavatam is realistic and is supported by empirical evidence, then that's reason for taking that devotional approach seriously. Yeah?
I have a short little story that might be interesting to the group if you'd like to hear it.
Yeah, I guess.
The personal story, I'll speak real quick.
Yeah.
About 12 to 15 years ago, I was up in Idaho Falls, sitting in the park.
Yeah.
And a strange man walked up. Well, he seemed kind of strange anyway, and we started swapping a strange story about him.
Yeah.
And he goes, well, here's one for you. And he goes, you won't believe it, but he says the absolute truth that he and some friends were up in the forest, way out in the middle of nowhere, and couldn't see somebody for months.
Yeah.
Some friends and somebody that heard rustling in the trees, and this person walked out.
Yeah.
And the person had gold hair, gold eyes, a vertical slit like a cat, and a nose like an elephant, a small little nose like an elephant that was actually moving. And the person put them on like a trance, and they were all standing there looking at this person. And the two of them ran off, and then he stood there for a while, the guy looked at him, and then he finally broke the trance, and he ran off too. He says, you know, that was my experience, that you'll never believe it. And he says, oh, that's in.
Yeah.
The kicker was, it was about 2 years after that, on television, on Channel 11, there was a show that came on that said the U.S. government is going to admit they had contact with UFOs and they wanted to break the story, let people know, and more information would come later. So I called the four friends and said, you've got to come over and see this, or the government's going to admit UFOs. So they come over, and at the end of the show, this Air Force colonel from Holloman Air Force Base comes on and goes, here's the part of the show you all been waiting for, we're going to actually admit UFOs. He gives his name, what Air Force Base he came from. He says he could come and, you know, get a copy of this whole thing and write a letter and all that. And the strange part was, he said that a flying saucer landed at Holloman Air Force Base. The jeep drove up, this guy got out. He had gold hair, gold eyes like a vertical slit, and a little nose like an elephant. And my friend started thinking, you know, this is so stupid, you know, a little nose like an elephant. And then I told him the story that this guy told me. That he had this experience before this. No, that's why he's not so stupid, because the guy that I've had was completely disconnected from the whole thing on television, seeming. So the story was finished up real quick. The guy said that this is what the aliens told him. They went into a small building, and he said it went on television about home there, that they were from the planet Uranus, from our solar system, and that they had come to invite us to join the United Federation of Planets.
Well, that's interesting. I'll tell you, I know a little about the Holloman Air Force Base story. I'm not so sure.
Well, that was a different Holloman Air Force Base story. There's another one besides that.
Okay, maybe that's...
You're talking about the one where they have 60 hours of film about the little gray guys.
The little gray guys.
They have a 50 line.
That was a different Holloman Air... Okay, I'm familiar with that Holloman Air Force Base.
That's a different one. Okay. Talk to them later.
Anyway, you had a question for some time?
Just a comment you made, that you used this extensive research also about Bali Maharaj airplane and AIDS cancer. He had one that disappeared, then appeared, he fought with injury, he got shot down, then Sukracharya brought him back to life, and he performed a sacrifice where a chariot was purchased. So apparently they come up and said, this blew him back up to the heavenly planet when he defeated him. So they can actually produce.
Well, in Vedic literature, there are plenty of amazing flying machines. I didn't go over that, But there are lots of examples, apart from Salva's vehicle. There's the flying city of Hiranyapura, which was a good one. This is a city flying in outer space, inhabited by the Paloma and Kalakea Danavas. And they were just having a gay time flying around from planet to planet in their city. And they had one of these benedictions from Brahma that they couldn't be slain by so and so many different types of entities, but humans weren't mentioned in the list. So when Arjuna went up to the heavenly planet to meet Indra, who was his father, Indra actually revealed the real reason for the whole thing of even having Arjuna be born. Indra, it seems, was a master politician. So, and that was that Arjuna would come up there and he would kill off these demons who had benedictions that demigods couldn't kill them, but humans could. So he wiped out the Vatakavacha demons and also he devastated the flying city of Hiranyapura. But, yeah?
I was wondering, in Europe, is there not so much conspiracy?
Pardon me?
The French scientists, he was pretty reputable. Belgian Air Force and the process of meeting, is there more of a scientific acceptance in Europe, or is it
France and Belgium seem to be exceptional. France is exceptional in that they are making these scientific investigations. They haven't done an incredible amount, but they have cases in which all kinds of scientists have taken soil samples and done chemical tests in the places where the UFO landed and shown different effects and so on and so forth. So that is going on in France. In the United States, it's only done... Yeah, well, Velasco concluded that it's something we just don't know what it is, landed in this guy's field, and involved very high temperatures, a couple of tons of pressure, and affected all the plants. So, that's there. In Belgium, it's also a bit unusual because the Air Force actually released the tape showing the radar screen on the F-16, which locked onto this UFO. Now, in the United States, the military would never release something like that, as far as I'm aware. By the way, I have spoken personally to one man, who, again, I've spoken to him for about a couple of hours total, who was an engineer working for the Navy at the Naval Ordnance Test Center at China Lake, California, in the early 1950s, doing metric photography. They were doing photographs of missile tests and other kinds of weapons tests with very high-quality cameras so you could get the coordinates of the object as it flew from the photographs. So he told me that he was in charge of the group of men who were doing this work. He told me they frequently got UFOs in their photographs of the weapon. A UFO would come and follow the missile or whatever. And he described to me that he personally saw a UFO. He said a Air Force cargo plane was coming in for a landing at about, I think, 600 feet altitude, he said. At about 300 feet altitude, underneath it, this object was flying. It consisted of a front half, which was a large diameter disc, and a smaller back half, which was also circular. And the back half, he said, was amber-colored like an artist's drawing triangle, if you know what those old triangles look like. And the front half looked as though it was made of silvery metal. The thing was coming along. At a certain point, he said, it flipped up to the wing of the plane in the blink of an eye. In other words, it went to 300 feet up like that, hovered next to the wing, because they have compassion for the people down on the earth. Yep, we need a bit of compassion around here.
I just don't find it so hard to imagine why somebody would ever be attracted to something other than Krishna.
Well, that's the basic problem of the conditioned soul.
Okay, as an ordinary, picking up a lucky person running around the planet,
You always want what you think is best at the moment, right? You know, yep. Take that an hour, most properly, you know, whatever is best. But one of Christian's characteristics is that he's the best of whatever he has.
That's right. So we should all be attracted to Christians.
But wouldn't that mean that we're all ready to attract Christians?
In our hearts, we are. We're covered over by this ignorant gobbledygook.
So is this providing like another function, you know, that we're not aware of, that we're performing some, you know, portion of somebody else's play or something, you know, that we don't know what's going on?
Yeah, we're actors on the stage, like Shakespeare says, acting out permanent plays. Okay, well, what we've got to do is realize, wait a minute, the play is over, let's go back home.
When we get off the stage, though, sometimes we think, well, now that I'm off the stage, I'm in my so-called normal. Now I'm willing to go back on the stage.
Another planet, which is one theory, how did they arrive? How did they arrive there? Well, you could say, well, by evolution. Well, the chances that evolution would produce a human-like form on another planet are exceedingly remote if you analyze according to the theory of evolution. It's equally remote that a human-like form would be produced on the Earth, but you could say, well, that's what came up. You know, if you throw a bunch of dice and get a certain combination, something's got to come up. Whatever comes up, it was improbable, but that's what came up. So you can say, well, the dice were thrown, humans are what came up. But now to do it twice, that's another thing. Because if you throw the dice and you get a certain pattern, now you throw the dice twice, you get the same pattern or a close pattern, you can calculate the probabilities would be very small. In other words, it doesn't make sense in terms of evolution that anything remotely human would appear on another planet by that process. And they couldn't have evolved on this planet, according to science, because there are no fossils or anything that would support that idea. So whichever way you look at it, the theory of evolution takes a real blow if this is real. So that's another point. Apart from the fact that, of course, another thing is that psychical phenomena are supported by these things. Another thing I even forgot to discuss was reincarnation, which also out-of-body experiences in connection with UFO phenomena. That's another whole subject. People have the experience of going on board the UFO and then they go out of their body. In other cases, they go out of their body and then they go on board the UFO. So anyway, the hook has come out. Now, I'll go to the Srila Prabhupada. What they report is that half-human, half-alien children seem to be produced, which are kept in the with the aliens, and shown to the women. And the women are asked to hold them as though that would give them some feeling of security or physical intimacy, and so on. There are lots of reports written up in detail in this book and in other books also of that kind of thing, which of course is really controversial, but that's the kind of thing that people are reporting.
Barney Hill.
Yeah.
Getting the ulcers. Would that do? I mean, is that an example of something going wrong in the body after these examinations or what have you? Or is that his stress?
That would appear to be stress because the memory was suppressed. In other words, he couldn't consciously remember what had happened, but he was very disturbed by it. So therefore, it came out in the form of ulcers. But if you can bring the memory to consciousness, then you can resolve the conflict, and then you feel better. This happens generally in psychology, in all kinds of different circumstances. That if a person has a repressed memory of some frightening experience, or like sexual abuse as a child, or something like that, this can produce physical symptoms. And then if through hypnotherapy or something like that, they can bring forth the memory, then they're released of the symptoms. So that does go on. That seems to be what was happening with him.
So are there a lot of people who suffer cancer or some kind of malady because of having been examined or what?
People sometimes report physical maladies of different kinds. Oddly enough, though, people also report cures. And this is a common sense. happens quite frequently. This guy, for example, claims that his health was improved greatly. He felt very satisfied about the whole experience.
How did you describe him? Which guy was?
This is the guy, the university professor from North Dakota, civil rights worker,
okay.
That guy. He thought it was just great.
His neighbor had over for
yeah, he said, after that I don't get colds and, you know, all kinds of improvements physically, he said. Feels 10 years younger, you know. He's about 55 years old, so he's getting on a bit. Feel like a young man again.
These Fridays, UFO encounters, why?
So, of course, now this guy, he'd take a very suspicious viewpoint on that. He'd say either that, you know, they're just setting this guy up in order to make propaganda for themselves. But he takes a suspicious negative viewpoint. So, all these...
Did he describe the abductors as beautiful, like you said?
No, he described the standard ugly-looking guy. with the big eyes and the whole thing.
Any descriptions of the visitors with no features at all, just white?
There are cases of, featureless beings, just like the Pascagoula case.
Facial features were not there.
No facial features.
No eyes.
Yeah, they seem to have bodily features entirely covered with, well, like thick elephant skin. It's a very weird case. Very thick and crinkled.
The main feeling was that they were not even made of organic.
Well,
or if they were organic, they were some kind of robotic.
Yeah, he felt they were robotic.
They didn't move their feet.
That was an interesting. Well, they never moved their legs remained together. And they just moved by floating, levitating. That was
Any differences of
people have speculated that. I've heard that speculation. I really don't know. But I've heard people argue, well, this guy, James Harder, engineering professor at UC Berkeley. He's now emeritus. He's been studying these things for years. And he presents that theory. He says they're the inexperienced ones who sort of, they're kind of crude in their dealings. And then there are the more experienced ones who, you never remember anything from them. They're so expert. But I don't know, that's his idea he has.
They have theories in terms of if they had abductions of people coming back, people theorize that also there's people disappearing theories.
Well, the whole disappearances, that's another whole subject about which there's quite a literature. People who mysteriously disappear and there's never a trace of them. That could be due to all kinds of things, foul play of different kinds and Nobody knows. Nobody sees any obvious connection because they don't see UFOs in connection with the crop circles.
You saw the show that you had filmed from. That had the crop circles section.
Right.
You saw that?
Yeah.
And they had the just lights. But they had the thing where it got to the ground and they interpreted it as some kind of microwave radiation.
Yeah. You see, but you see, in those crop circles, they don't see something that looks like a craft that comes flying down. They may see glowing light. That's been reported. But they don't see what looks like a flying machine. So, now in the case of the cattle mutilations, they do. Now, there are lots of reports of UFO-type flying machines in the same areas where the cows are then found to be cut up and all that kind of thing. So there it is reported, but in the case of the crop circles, it's not.
Doesn't necessarily mean that there's not some way of
it. They could be.
Just out of any place.
There's no direct visible connection to the bar.
There's no visible connection tying that with UFOs. But the indication is, one would say, that some kind of intelligence is behind it.
You would lean toward a living entity who may have propelled all the intuition.
Yeah, I mean, for all I know, the... well, you see, another whole interesting aspect is, according to Vedic literature, there are other inhabitants of these same countries that we live in. And in Europe, in places like England and Ireland and so on, they were called fairies or the leprechauns and various names. In Scandinavian countries, they were called elves and so on. And the whole idea is that they were the original inhabitants of the country, and they're still living there, even though people are living there. Now, that's another whole subject if you want to get into what happens in Ireland. You can ask some of the devotees from Ireland. But anyway.
Mischievous.
Yeah, they tend to be mischievous. The Irish story, interestingly enough, is that these beings called the Tuatha De Danann were the original inhabitants of the country. And people later moved in. The Tuatha De Danann are still there. And that means the descendants of Donna. Donna is the same as Bridget. That was a god of the Irish. And that was incorporated into Roman Catholicism as St. Bridget. And right down here on Mission Boulevard, I happen to notice there's a church to St. Bridget. So Bridget still lives on. But anyway, Donna was a goddess of the Irish. Interestingly enough, Danu is a goddess described in the Bhagavatam. And the Danavas are the descendants of Danu. I don't know if there's any connection. But supposedly the Tuatha De Danann are still there. And so, who knows? But there are all kinds of stories. That's another whole category.
My European question was, I would like to mention this idea that kind of a changing worldview to the Vedic picture.
Yeah.
Is that changing worldview more in Europe?
In Europe,
America, or
what you find in Europe is, first of all, the same kinds of things are reported, abductions and all this sort of thing. A lot of European intellectuals take the point of view of explaining away the whole thing psychologically. That's fairly prominent in Europe. A lot of people in America who study the UFO question think they must be extraterrestrials, from, you know, beings from other planets. In Europe, the tendency more is to think, well, it must be some kind of psychological manifestation, maybe with a paranormal component to it. But then there are people in Europe who study it very scientifically. However, to my knowledge, they don't get involved with the entities. But that's too weird. They're just concerned with the ground traces and the radar tracking and all this kind of thing. But apart from that, there are all kinds of close encounters and abductions and so on in Europe.
But the more so than America?
I don't know if it's more so.
I guess again, what I'm getting at is like one of these books would be more popular in Europe or would be more popular in America.
I think it varies depending on the publicity situation at any given time. Because right now in America, for some reason, the conspiracy theorists can really go to town on this one too, there's been a huge amount of publicity concerning UFOs. And also all these books have come out recently like that one. So it's been given a lot of emphasis now in the United States. I don't think that's there so much in Europe. You see, Whitley Strieber came out with his book, and even though that's just one man's story, and that's all it is, it's not even supported by any corroborating evidence, it had a huge impact, sold a vast number of copies, it was on bestseller lists for months. And that became such a phenomenon that, in fact, this guy wrote a book about Whitley Strieber's book. Well, they went after him. Yep. He woke up with the famous nosebleed phenomenon. Yeah, all this kind of thing. That's another whole topic. But anyway, yeah, things started happening with him, it appears. But I mean, he did go and stay overnight in his driver's cabin, right? That's sort of asking for it.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's curious the way that book is written. On the one hand, he takes this viewpoint of real skepticism, you know, hard-nosed. And on the other hand, he tells equally weird stories about himself. But what do you make of that?
I remember a very low-hearted tried to get into the CD and crashed spacecraft.
Yeah, he said he did.
Yeah, he said it was denied entrance.
Yeah, he said in at least three letters that he wrote to different people, he maintained that he tried to do that. Which is interesting that somebody in Barry Goldwater's position would do something like that.
And then he'd be turned down.
Hmm?
Well, that would be...
Well, sure he'd be turned down. Because, top secret. But, anyway. So...
Another question. Really yeah. The difference that we have. I don't get too many opportunities.
Yeah.
You know, I was first introduced to it in the movie, The Philadelphia Experiment, and
uh-huh.
Turned out there was people wrote about it, and just said that's an amazing
yeah.
thing.
Yeah, right.
And my memory is pretty foggy on it, but I'm relating it somewhat to time travel. There's some kind of element of that, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, yeah.
But I wanted to ask the main specific question. The Vedic view on whether or not it is a reality of you know, time, past and future, to
yeah.
what degree it is substantial or it is not existing, because it is not existing. Either it's unmanifested, could exist, or it just does not exist. I mean, kind of a broad question.
Well, the nature of time and Vedic tradition?
Yeah.
Well, there's some idea
future.
That the future is sort of laid out because there are sages who are tree called Yam, like Narada Muni, who would just go to Krishna and say, well, I'll see you doing this and I'll see you doing that and so forth. Vyasadeva was seeing what would happen in the future. So the idea of being able to see the future is there. And the past is tree called Yam, past, present, and future. I interpret the present to mean you can also see at a distance. Because these sages could do that also. Just like Sanjaya was reporting what was happening at the battlefield of Kurukshetra. So, that seems to imply that it's sort of all laid out. And then the question is, well, then how do you relate that to free will? If it's all laid out, then how can we make decisions as to what we're going to do? It's all determined. But one answer to that is, our free choice may be perfectly well known to Krishna well in advance. It's still our free choice. Krishna may know it, but it doesn't mean we don't make the choice. So we can have free will, but Krishna still knows, and some sage, by the mercy of Krishna, could see. So that the sage could see what we're going to do by our free will.
Yeah, I've never really argued or had an argument with that understanding.
Yeah.
That's what I might do.
Yeah.
But in terms of, you know, so much science fiction has been written about, you know, being in the present and traversing to past
and
future.
Now, the idea of time travel is another thing. I haven't seen in the Vedic literature any reference to, say, going into the past, where you come into the inevitable problem of what happens if you kill your grandmother, right? Then you couldn't have been born, so you couldn't have got into the past to kill her. So therefore you didn't go into the past, so therefore you were born. Then you went into the past and killed her, therefore you couldn't have been born, and therefore you couldn't have done it. So you get into a total contradiction. Yeah. Now, that Philadelphia experiment thing, if you want to delve into far out the animals, and I saw a videotape in which this fellow, whose name I forget, gave this testimony, which was about the weirdest thing I've ever heard, about time travel. Now, I don't know if the whole thing is totally wacko or what. I'd like to see some confirming evidence in which somebody else tells a similar story. But he told some far out time travel story involved with the Philadelphia experiment. Very
so it, was it similar to the movie where they jump and shift in the future?
Well, somehow he got zapped into the future. I mean, he was back in the 1940s or so, and he got zapped into the 1980s. But just to figure out what happened when, because of course everything was out of order in time then, was really difficult. So, since that was an isolated piece of testimony, and I've never run across anything else like it, I don't know what to make of that.
The ship disappeared, but that was...
And I don't know if the ship disappeared or not.
But
they say
that a general overview of it, we tend to just be skeptical because our philosophy does not give explanations about time travel per se.
Well, number one, our philosophy doesn't mention it to my knowledge. I've not run across a case in Vedic literature where somebody goes into the past. Number two, there are those paradoxes. You go back and kill your grandmother, so then what happens?
Logic tends to
indicate that there's a problem with going into the past.
What about the fact that you might appear in the past? Is that a self paradox?
Well, you see, as far as I'm aware, Krishna, when he appears, I mean, he appears at all times, all at once, and he's aware of past, present, and future, and the whole thing all at once.
So
for him, it's not a matter of travel. He's already there. He's in the future, he's in the past, he's in the present, he's everywhere at once, all at one moment, like that. Well, living entity can be in
place. We're keeping in the context of time, though.
Right. In terms of places, you can be in more than one place at a time. Narada Muni has been known to do that. So, in one sense, maybe you could be in two times at once, in terms of the order of your experience, but I don't know.
Terms of the order of your experience?
Well, we are in two times in the sense that we were here in, say, 1957, and we're here now. But the point is, the us of now remembers the us of 1957, and not the other way around. Whereas if the us of 1957 remembered the us of 1992, that would be an unusual situation. The thing is, people have precognitive experiences where they see things that will happen in the future, like that whole thing of the sinking of the Titanic. Fairly well documented. All kinds of people foresaw that the ship would sink and they canceled their reservations and things like that. And I'd really like to check it out. I haven't personally checked to see if it's really true, but I have read that a novel was written about a book called, not exactly the Titanic, I think the Titan or something like that. There's a book about a ship supposedly unsinkable, called the Titan, I think, or something like that. About the same size as the Titanic. It also had the problems. There were too few lifeboats because the people were overconfident. They thought it couldn't sink. And sure enough, it went out and on its maiden voyage, it sank. This was a novel written before the Titanic was built.
That's happened on a number of occasions recently. Some woman was an interview writer for a novel. And the actual thing occurred years later, same exact name, almost the same circumstance where she was shot. But with some kind of connection, she wrote the same type.
Well, that'd be an interesting one to look into. But another point regarding this kind of thing is that if there are a lot of accounts of the same type of thing, then you begin to think that there's more credibility to it. If there's just one, then it's hard to tell. So in the case of the testimony regarding the Philadelphia experiment, it's sort of a unique case. I don't know of anything else comparable to it. But you see, the thing about this UFO abduction business is now there are hundreds of cases, which are practically stereotyped in their similarity to one another. It's quite curious.
Do you ever have anybody who was like, you get two people who never met each other and then abducted and met another human being and UFO?
Well, there are things like that happen. I don't know of any case in which. Pardon me? Yeah. There are cases where people meet somebody else on a UFO, but I don't know of any case in which later they meet down on the Earth and compare notes. And to make it evidential, they'd have to first meet some investigators and then later be brought together. I do know one case sort of along those lines was like this. There were at a summer camp on Lake Champlain in New York State, a teenage boy and girl who slightly knew each other, summer camp workers, were abducted from the dock of the summer camp and returned. They both suffered amnesia for what happened during the abduction experience. After the event, they returned to their cabins somewhat in a dazed state. They didn't talk to one another about what happened. A few days later, they both left the camp and went their separate ways. During those few days, they never got together and talked about the incident. The boy had said a few things about it, but everybody laughed at him and poked fun at him and so forth, and he just clammed up. And he never spoke to the girl at all. And she apparently didn't even say anything to anyone about it. So they went their separate ways and never met again for a period of 10 or so years, I think. At one point, the boy, now 10 years later, got in touch with a UFO investigator, a fellow named Webb, who's actually the director of the planetarium in the Science Museum in Boston. So he's a responsible sort of person. So he himself got in contact with the woman. They traced her down. She'd gotten married and so forth and had kids and all that. He had them separately hypnotized. They came out with stories separately. They had not had a chance to meet or discuss. The stories corroborated one another quite accurately. So there's that case. Things like that. So,
it's kind of sad. Even the gentleman here who related the story that in his personal experience he had a unique experience hearing some guy 2 years previous in a TV thing.
Yeah.
You know, and in response to that, by having that laugh,
yeah.
You know the response he's going to go through is just
right.
One to plan down.
These things, you see, there are a lot of cases like that. If someone tells a story like that, people say, But the thing is, if these cases are recorded, then they begin to pile up from all over the place. And you think, well, something must be going on. So, I don't know about your case. I mean, I never heard of anyone with an elephant-like nose.
This is a third-party case you're hearing.
Yeah, it was a third-party story.
But I'm touching upon the fact of how we received it. Just because it wasn't within our experience, we've seen an elephant nose kind of guy, you know.
But like, a lot of us, I mean, his father had a UFO experience, and I was like, oh, he even said he saw one. So, I mean, I think, isolatedly, I think our conditioning at this point in this type of service will help to overcome the conditioning, which is really along the scientific edge. I mean, they've influenced it to think it's ridiculous. And I think that's a little subtle example of how by nature we're going to be, you know, like.
But the scientist is initially skeptical until he's given, like Professor said, that was.
Well, you see, there's no need to engage in ridicule and all that kind of thing.
Yes.
Because, you see, a person who's honestly skeptical admits that he doesn't know. So what is there to laugh about? If you don't know, then it could be one way, it could be another way, you just don't know. So the scientific approach would be just to note that down and say, okay, there it is. We'll come back to that and see if it's confirmed or disconfirmed. And, I mean, from a strictly scientific point of view, all of these things can be researched. You never can come to an absolute conclusion. There are no absolutes in science. Any conclusion based on your senses has to be imperfect. But then even though it's imperfect, it doesn't mean that your senses are useless, because we use our senses all the time. You just have to realistically realize that